I'm here with Giovanni De Micheli from the EPFL in Lausanne, important institute, I think. But today we are in Barcelona. And in Barcelona we are at the HiPEAC Conference, one of the many conferences you must have visited in your lifetime, I think. What makes the HiPEAC Conference special in your opinion?
Oh, it's a great conference. It's great mainly for the community. The people who are attending, the expectations that we have about the presenters showing new things, and also the importance of computing for Europe and the European Union, of
course. Because we can have more developments in Europe, you feel? Or is Europe on par with what is happening around the world on computing?
I think Europe can do better. And I think it must do better because everything that we do today, from traffic to health, goes through some sort of computing. And we need to be able to own more of the technology. Yeah. There is, we have great companies, we have great silicon foundries, but I think that we can do more.
Yeah, yeah. And to do more also requires new thinking about how computer architectures are there. I feel in your keynote speech this morning, you addressed, or you mentioned it, the phoenix of computer architectures. I feel we're in a sort of an interesting phase where we say a bit goodbye to the traditional computer architectures and the faraway promise of quantum computing. And I'm interested to hear what is your opinion about the in-between. What is actually the next phase in computer architecture?
Sure, the notion of the phoenix is that, you know, computing reinvents itself. Computing can be reborn out of its own ashes. And that is important because we will have new technologies, we'll have new ways of making computing tomorrow, and we have to make that happen in these times. So we have to be able to use the computing infrastructure that we have today. We have to use the talents that we have today in Europe in order to do new design, new emerging design.
Yeah, yeah. Now, this is all about out of Europe, but you have a long career. You've worked at Stanford, I remember. So what in your career, because we're talking about students, we're talking about new people, new ideas, but what in your career has been vital in understanding, okay, this is what we need? Can you recall a light bulb in your whole career or in your research?
Light bulbs are people. People whom you meet, who have enthusiasm, who drive you to work and with passion. And so people that I remember at Stanford, Robert Dutton and John Hennessy, who actually hired me at Stanford, and Patrick Ebischer, who hired me at EPFL, all people who are ready for the discussion, who are ready for new ideas, who are ready to throw up what I've been planning to do for many years. If you have something that can be new and more up to solve the problem.
Yeah, yeah. So it in many ways is passion, but also it is and the research and also the network of people you're working with. And that is also, I think, part of this whole HiPEAC conference. You're meeting up with people and getting new ideas.
It's environment. You need to get to a critical mass with people and problems. And when the things start rolling, it rolls by itself.
Yeah.
You throw an idea to a graduate student and he or she will come up with another idea and the other one will pick it from there. And I tend to think that some of the best PhD students that I had, my graduates, are people who didn't do as a thesis what I told them to do.
Oh, now we're talking. And that is because they discovered something completely in different field and a different angle to what you've been telling, and then they say, okay, forget about Giovanni, we're going to do it ourselves.
Well, I have two examples. When I was giving in my talk that we were working on devices and we discovered these properties of these majority gates, and one of my students, Luca Maru, had this brilliant idea of actually formalizing the majority algebra and making a tool that would work in CMOS as well. That was not part of the plan, but was extremely impactful on academia and industry because industry is using this tool. And the other person who has also been diverting away from my plans is Jerry Yang. Jerry Yang, with Dave Filer, they were working in my group on synthesis, and they had this idea of making Yahoo, and one day they came and told me, Professor De Micheli, we are making this company. We're going to list the various things that you can find on the internet. And I told him, well, we can list the patent, the inventions, the technical paper. And he looked at me and told me, no. We are going to list cleaners, restaurants, car dealers, things that everybody would need on a daily basis. And I said, well, I told him, well, that's probably very trivial. It's like the Yellow Pages. And he told me, exactly. I'm going to put the Yellow Pages online. And that was history. That's a big company.
So, you know, it all comes down to research and students. If you have, you know, if you say you're on the European Commission and you say you're looking about what is happening in Europe, what would your where would you put your money in terms, will it be in fundamental research, will it be in quantum computing, will it be in students, will it be in the total system of companies working together? What do you feel is important to create a sort of a breakthrough in Europe on this?
Yeah, it's necessary. Somehow, if you read across Draghi's report on Europe and technology, this comes across. But I think there are two important things. One, fund technology is not necessarily one that relates back to chip design, to being able to manufacture computing systems, and the other one to create the environment, the people, hire the talent. We are still low on talent in Europe to do this, and create the enthusiasm, create the fact that, you know, newspaper talk about it, talk about these breakthroughs, bring to the people the notions that we are doing wonderful thing in Europe, you know, going from car to planes with technologies done in here. And so make sure that students stay in engineering, computer science, and apply their skills to making a better Europe.
Yeah, I'd like to take you back to the roadmap of computer architecture, where we have in the history we have the x86 architecture, and traditional computing, as I say, the von Neumann principles. In the future, we might have quantum computing, but what are the technologies you're looking now at to bridge this gap? What is important? Where should we look at?
I think that the important point is heterogeneity, diversity, because our systems are very far away from the old computers that were actually solving one type of problems. Most of the computers that we use are embedded computers that work in connection with all kind of electronic or mechanical devices. And there, the fact that specific functions can be best implemented in a special technology, it's extremely important. Again, think of automotive, where you need to have control, which is classic, and then you need to have signals that actually have high currents through that. So you need to have mixtures of technology like silicon and silicon carbide, for example, or silicon and gallium nitride on the other side. And that's extremely important. That happens in Europe. It's still not known well enough.
Yeah. And then in the far future, we're looking at quantum computing. I heard you saying, you know, quantum computing is not for everyone and everything. What will be the typical fields where you've will first recognize what quantum computing can offer, if it's going to happen as we hope it will happen?
I think that the first practical application will be related to physics and chemistry, to be able to understand how to control or catalyze reactions.
Yeah.
Just because their models are somehow similar to the models used in computing, and so in quantum computing, and so I think that there is really a possibility of making a major improvement. Then there are some large-scale problems that can be actually made more efficient by quantum computing. Think that searching, which is a universal technique, you know, can be sped up by a factor of two, a quadratic factor by quantum computing. Where I don't think quantum computing be usable is in the typical serial computation that we every day do on a computer.
Yeah.
That I think we will have a marginal advantage by using these machines.
Yeah, but you are confident that quantum computing will actually get to a point where we say, okay, these are the applications we're looking at, and these are that is not just research, but it will become a reality.
A reality and a market, yes.
Yeah, okay. One other thing which was popping up in your keynote speech, and also to close off this conversation, was the relevance of this all. New computer systems. Some people might say, you know, let's stick to what we have. You know, we can do this, we can do that, etc. Why always this push? Is it important to have all these new developments and to put all this money, or would you say, okay, is there a sort of a point where, okay, now it's saturated, now we're done?
I think there are lots of things to discover. This is one very important thing. I think also that in engineering, we are still, and in electrical engineering, in electronics, we are still very far from the optimum solution to problems. Mm. So on one side, we should not trust the commercial ventures that tell us, buy your products, you'll be fine, mm-hmm. and there's nothing better than we can do, which is true. Mm-hmm. Nobody else sometimes says something better, but there is something better than what they can offer in terms of design tools down the line.
Yeah.
The other problem is with scientists and academics, because fashions are fashions, and people like to jump from one topic to another one according to how many people listen to them.
Yeah.
And very few people actually stick to the fundamental problems and keep on actually working on them. And it's very important that this exercise is done.
Yeah.
The real academics, and I was mentioned Donald Knuth in my talk, this great scientist who published all this book on the art of computing programming and actually making a corpus which is of use to many, many engineers.
Yeah. To close our conversation, you, Italian from, raised and born and raised as an Italian, you went to Stanford, you went to EPFL. What is on your wish list? What is something you really say, okay, this is what I really am looking forward to do, or to research, or to understand?
The fact that I spend my life in three different parts of the world led me to think that there's a home everywhere. And I have very good relation with my Asian colleagues in Japan and in China, mm-hmm. as well as with my American colleagues and South American colleagues. And so I don't see any reason why we should build barriers. There's no barrier to knowledge. There's no barrier that's useful to the advancement of technology, if that is good technology. And so actually, I look forward to acting in such a way that we first within Europe and in outside Europe, we keep an osmosis of people and technology, because that's beneficial to all.
Okay, well, thank you very much for our conversation. Have a good time here at the conference, and hope to see you soon.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.